back here. So the first half of this concert is dedicated to one of the most fascinating figures in the history of music, Franz Liszt. One of the things that makes Liszt so fascinating is he has so many different aspects, many of which almost seem in direct contradiction with each other. For instance, he was probably the first and greatest self-promoter, the idea of selling yourself, of building up an image, of driving people into a frenzy, that he would be easily considered to be like one of the great charlatans. At the same time, he was one of the greatest innovators, the most original thinkers, would take enormous chances. He was a man of the world who loved wine, women, and song, probably not in that order. Well, maybe in that order. But he also was deeply religious and spent many years in parts of years, as an abbey in the Catholic Church in retreat, not seeing anyone, living in a little cell. So it's full of contrasts. And the three works actually tonight illustrate some of these contrasts, although they come from the same period of his life, sort of the middle period. Liszt, starting in 1837, really started off his career as an international concert pianist, really the first one. He really invented the idea of traveling all over the world, in his case all over Europe, playing hundreds of concerts and just wowing audiences. He would arrive in a city on a horse in a Hungarian costume with a sword. He would throw his gloves to the women, who probably returned them to him later. He would have three pianos and change the position so that everybody could see his silhouette in the best angle. And this went on for 9 years. And I think in 1848, he was getting very tired of it. And in 1848, he was touring in what is now the Ukraine. And he met a noblewoman who was one of the richest women in Europe and in Russia, very closely related to the Tsar, actually, who had an enormous estate. And she was married and had a kid, but estranged from her husband. And anyway, they fell in love. And Liszt spent a winter in her place, as he said, in glorious solitude with her in the icy silence of the Ukraine with her 20,000 serfs. Probably not even an ironic statement. And Liszt, who had always been extremely religious, really decided during this period to give up his life as a concert pianist, to give up all the glory, as it were, and to settle down to a much more serious musical life. And this led to him taking a job in Weimar, a very idealistic choice because Weimar had been the city of both Goethe and Schiller. It was considered the German Renaissance city. And so this winter was a very important winter for him. And during this winter, he picked up an old project from the 1830s, when he was a very young man, when he was very much under the influence of two important French spiritual leaders named Lamartine and Lamennais. Lamartine was a great writer and who was eventually actually excommunicated from the church for what he wrote. And Liszt had started a piece, had written a single piece, called Harmonie Poétique et Religieuse, Religious and Poetic Harmonies, during this very early period. And then he picks this up again at this later time of this winter and starts elaborating it into a 10-piece set. And the first piece I'm going to play tonight is the biggest piece of the set, actually, although there's some other big ones, and Benediction of God in the Solitude. And it's introduced with a part of a prose poem by Lamartine talking about finding God in solitude. The second group of pieces of Liszt show another aspect of Liszt, also related to literature in a way, which was Liszt was an enormous transcriber of his own music, of other composers' music, and most of the transcriptions, not all, but most were done for the purpose of musical proselytizing, evangelization. Composers that he believed in deeply, that he would be able to promote by making versions of their music for piano that he would play or that other people would play. And this is very much the case with these three songs. He actually transcribed over 200 songs in his life for piano solo. And the three songs that I'm playing are transcriptions of two of them of Clara Schumann, Robert Schumann's wife, who was one of the great pianists of the 19th century, and then one very famous song by Schumann himself. One of the things that's sort of a sidelight interest to these is that at this point in life, the Schumanns were artistically and intellectually enemies of Liszt. Schumann had married, Clara Schumann's father was a very, very conservative musical figure, and Liszt represented everything they hated. And Liszt and Schumann and his wife did not spare Liszt's ego in their writings. They wrote terrible things, but it didn't matter. Liszt had this, he said, génie oblige, the genius obliges. They're great, he was going to promote them. So, and these three songs, they're all three love songs. The third, very, very famous, called Widmung, Dedication, is actually the first song in the first group of songs that Liszt wrote, and the first piece he wrote, or published anyway, after marrying Clara, after this long and stormy courtship. And then the third piece I'm going to play, a very famous one, it's interesting, it's also a transcription, but it's a transcription of one of his own orchestral pieces, although it's much more famous now as a piano piece. And this piece, Mephisto Waltz, really manifests one of Liszt's obsessions, which is the Faust legend and the devil. Liszt, like most of the 19th century, was completely obsessed with the Faust legend, and very much because in the version of Goethe, which was this dominating force for the 19th century in Germany, but in all of Europe, really, Faust is the artist who sells his soul to the devil in order to create. And of course, in the Goethe Faust, ultimately, Faust is saved because what he wants is beauty. And even though he sells his soul to the devil and does terrible things, in the end, he's nevertheless saved. The story, this particular piece also has a strong literary connection. It's actually always to be published with this poem in front. The poem is not by Goethe, but it's based on Goethe too, by a romantic poet named Lenau. And the poem describes an episode where Liszt and Mephistopheles, Mephisto, the devil, who has transformed Liszt into this irresistible, sexy young man, arrive in a village where a wedding is about to take place. You hear the music very vividly, this very rustic band tuning up. And the first part of the piece really represents, I think, this extremely dashing character of Faust as he's been transformed. And Faust has his eye on this young woman at the party, who unfortunately is the bride. The breaks of the game, I guess. Anyway, the character of the music changes. There's a very seductive waltz scene in the middle. Kind of a sideline. All of Liszt's love music, especially his erotic music, is always sad. To Liszt, somehow there's some kind of fall involved. And we hear the devil sneaking up and sort of snickering at them. And the devil takes his violin and plays and turns this innocent village wedding into some kind of riotous orgy, and which is represented to a large extent in virtuosity in the music. And at the just before the end, we have an example of how 19th century audiences, in a way, understood music better than we do today, or needed less illustration. There's an episode all of a sudden when the music stops and we hear a bird singing. And to anybody in the 19th century, the poem tells us too, that this bird is the nightingale. And the singing of the nightingale is always a sign to the 19th century exactly what in movies of the 1940s, after a love scene of it, then it fades away and then you see the couple smoking a cigarette. Well, the nightingale has the same significance.
Thank you.
tradition to interpret many works of art in terms of the fact that the composer or the writer or the painter who was about to create them would shortly after die. And so happens. And so the idea somehow that these works represent perhaps a vision from beyond the tomb or have some very special quality, which is related to the fact that the artist was at the end of his or her life. And in most cases, the problem of this is the basic fallacy is that the artist didn't know. Beethoven, when he wrote his late quartets, had no idea that he was going to die when he finished them. Tchaikovsky, when he wrote his Sixth Symphony, had no idea he was going to die when he finished it, etc. The Mahler in his last symphony. So the pieces have very deep and great meaning, but it's we with 2020 hindsight, are reading some of the significance. However, in the case of Schubert's last compositions, and the sonata I'm about to play is his very last composition, it's different, because Schubert really did know that he was dying. Schubert was 31 years old and had terrible syphilis, and by the time he wrote these last three sonatas, he was too ill to stay in his own apartment in Vienna. He was staying out in the country with his brother. And indeed, he died 5 or 6 weeks after he finished writing this last sonata. And so he very definitely knew. There's lots of indication in letters and things. What I feel that this special knowledge and special sense gave to this piece is not a sense necessarily of haunted foreknowledge or doom or fear, or although there are moments perhaps of that. But it creates something else, which is very, very special quality in Schubert, and especially in these last pieces, and of course, maybe especially in this one, which is that somehow time, which after all, music usually creates a sense of moving forward, of momentum, of telling a story in a sense that one thing leads to the other, like a page turner, like Beethoven was the great master. In this, on the other hand, time is often completely still, as if it's not so much that nothing is happening, but it's happening forever. It's been somehow suspended into this kind of magical, enchanted infinity. And maybe this is a reflection of having so little time left and making it last forever. Who knows? He has lots of ways of doing this. One of the most common and interesting is by creating what we call in music a moto perpetuo, perpetual motion, where the music sort of goes round and around, sometimes in a dance, sometimes as in the slow movement in a very sad march. But the sense of constantly going but not getting anywhere. And there's another very interesting, sometimes very almost very moving and almost humorous aspect, is that sometimes Schubert is like a tour guide who wants to show us this enormous cathedral, which is this work. This is an enormous work. This is 42, 43 minutes long. And if Beethoven writes an enormous work, his main interest at all times is for us to experience the work as a whole, to feel the architecture, the overall structure of the work. And Schubert, of course, has some of that too, but what happens is that Schubert walks in the door of this cathedral and sees the first chapel on the right side and says, this is so beautiful. I can't believe how beautiful this is. This is, and finally, he tears himself away to go to the next, and then this is so beautiful. and you can feel in the music these moments when he pushes himself to the next thing, and then he immediately gets captured in this wonderful enchantment again. The first moment, which is by far the longest, and also the one that creates, I think, the most sense of timelessness, has one very special feature, which, among many others, but one that I would like to call your attention to, and that's there's this very mysterious, very, very quiet trill and the bass that comes in several times. But one time, so at the transition going back to the repeat at the beginning, it comes in ferociously, terrifyingly, in the same trill. And this changes our perception of it, comes back many times later back in pianissimo again. But somehow this trill takes on a terrifying. Maybe this is one moment where we do have this awful presentiment of what's getting ready to happen to him. The second movement is one of the saddest pieces of music ever written. It's not a sad sonata as a whole, but this movement is extraordinarily sad. And it has this constant movement going forward, and yet staying absolutely in the same place. The third movement, on the other hand, is like, to me, a dance of angels. It's like, it doesn't have its feet on the ground at all. It's completely up in the air. In the middle section of it, however, we have one or two very unexpected ferocious accents, which perhaps remind us that we're not quite angels yet. And the last movement, Schubert returns to one of his favorite idioms, the sort of Viennese dance. But even here, even though the music dances, it gets caught in these moments of extraordinary beauty and then pulls itself forward one last time. Right before the end, it's as if he doesn't want to let go. The opening dance comes back, and he sort of regrets and sort of seems to hold on to it for a second, and then he sweeps it away.
Thank you.